Radio.
The Independent Republic of Mike Graham on Talk Radio.
So looking at the aftermath of the dreadful events of Friday afternoon, which happened literally just below the building from which I'm now broadcasting to you here at London Bridge. London Bridge still closed down. PM accused of exploiting deaths in terror attacks is the front page of The Guardian. Betrayed is the front page of The Daily Mirror. The angel stolen by pure evil on the front page of The Sun. And of course, The Times has the story, spy chiefs on alert for London Bridge copycats. Because what we have discovered over the course of the last few days is that basically the systems that we have in place for controlling known terrorists, people who have been arrested and put into prison, are simply no longer good enough and not fit for purpose. Let's talk to Dr. Paul Stott, research fellow at the Henry Jackson Society. Paul, a very good morning to you. Welcome.
Good morning, Mike.
It's hard to know where to begin here, really, isn't it? Because there are so many, like all of these terrible things that happened, there are so many things that have gone wrong sort of all at the same time. But there can be no doubt Boris Johnson is probably right now to say that they have to change the rules. They have to change the way that sentencing is done. They have to change the way that monitoring is done. And they have to change the whole system effectively, don't they?
Well, I think so, Mike. I think people are shocked and angry. The one thing people aren't is surprised.
Yes.
And I was just looking back, we did a document on Islamist terrorist cases at the Henry Jackson Society, and the section on Usman Khan, his original sentence, he shouldn't have been eligible for parole until the 28th of August 2021.
Right.
And his expected automatic release date should have been the 28th of December 2026. And he should have been on an extended license until 2031. All of that obviously changed with his appeal, which gave him this sentence of 16 years. And then it seems he was automatically released, having served eight years of that. And this really does need, we need a sea change now. We can't allow these mistakes to be repeated.
Well, we really can't, because the numbers of people out there, 74, I assume maybe 73 now, because one of them's been arrested, one of his cohorts, funnily enough, from the original case in Stoke. You know, it seems to me that Dominic Lawson's written a great piece today in the Mail talking about a culture and an ideology that we have in our prison systems and also in the sort of parole system, if you like. Of rehabilitation and of course, you know, forgiveness of people and giving them a second chance and all of that. I mean, we sort of have to change that as well, don't we?
I think there's a need for a culture change on several levels, Mike. I retweeted yesterday a piece somebody had written about these various sort of barristers and experts who appear on Twitter and in some of the comment pieces, giving you these sort of lofty opinions, but they don't really seem to tackle the fact that the sentencing system clearly isn't working if people can get out and commit such serious offences. The idea that you can compare or have similar procedures for somebody, for example, who's a repeat offender committing burglaries or car theft or fraud and a convicted terrorist is clearly just nonsense.
Yeah.
And if you look at Usman Khan's behaviour, you know, even when he was in prison, he seems to have been writing, asking to be placed on de-radicalisation courses. I think, you know, he had some support in getting on such a course. You know, he appears to have been able to pull the wool over people's eyes, very well-meaning people, but being well-meaning isn't necessarily the dominant approach we should have when dealing with terrorists.
Well, exactly right, and this is what Dominic Lawson says today. Amazing as it might be to so many alleged experts in the field, criminals do actually dissemble in order to achieve the early release that they crave. And then he talks about his own family suffering, not at the hands of a terrorist, but at the hands of a former convict who was allowed out early, who murdered his wife's cousin, because basically the people supervising him thought that he was all right because he'd attended an anger management course. You know, this is the kind of culture in which we live, and it's the kind of culture that has been in existence for decades in this country, and it's the kind of culture that has led to exactly what happened on Friday.
I think one of the ways you have to see terrorism, Mike, is that terrorist attacks are about making a statement and are about sending a message. And Usman Khan on Friday sent a message to us, and that message was, you are idiots. I can kick you along, and then I will get right into your bosom, and I will attack you. And there's not that much that you're going to do about it, because we're hardwired almost not to respond. And also, you know, see the best in people, and we're very sensitive to criticism, very scared, you know, the authority is increasingly scared of being called racist or Islamophobic. You know, it won't be too long until, I'm afraid, Friday's story pivots into what some people are comfortable in talking about, and that's, you know, racism, Islamophobia, alleged, you know, mistakes by politicians in their rhetoric, in their language, dog whistle politics. That will soon become the narrative if we allow it. So I'm afraid we really have to hold people's feet to the fire on this and say that these mistakes cannot be repeated. We need to be looking at these 74 individuals very closely, but we need a structural change and a cultural change, and the cultural change is going to be the hardest one to do.
Yeah, much has been made of the change in the law in 2008 by the Labour government, which I don't particularly want to dwell on, because to be honest, the Labour government and the Tory governments in the past sort of two decades or three have not been particularly brilliant at this. It's a terrible problem. Ever since 9/11, as Tony Blair said at the time, the world has changed. We live in a very different world. This guy was born and raised in Stoke. Just because his parents come from Pakistan, why would you automatically assume that he would become a Muslim fanatic? There's no reason to think that. However, it's very clear that there have been massive mistakes made around the monitoring of people like Anjem Chowdhury, around the de-radicalisation programmes, and around what goes on inside prison once these people go there.
Yes, and I'm glad you mentioned Anjem Chowdhury, because his group, Al-Muhajirun, has been central to so many terrorist plots, terrorist cases.
Yeah.
And it's worth remembering, when that group first emerged in the 1990s, it was regarded really as a bit of a joke. And there was a documentary, for example, John Ronson did, that sort of, you know, regarded these guys as just sort of all laughable idiots, and nobody will really fall for that. Well, the unfortunate thing is lots of people have, and that this group, you know, occurs again and again in a whole series of terrorist plots. And although the government after 7/7 prescribed Al-Muhajirun, what it was basically allowed to do was to set up a whole series of subsequent groups, Muslims Against Crusades, Islam for UK, you'll remember all the different names, the Sharia Project, and you know, basically you had the same group of guys just defying the law, gaming the law, by setting up new organisations. And what tended to happen was sometimes the authorities would prosecute them for particular offences. They were never prosecuted en masse for membership of an illegal organisation. And I think with hindsight, that was probably a significant mistake.
Mm.
What we've seen with the far-right group, National Action, is the exact opposite approach, making the organisation illegal, and then when the guys involved are still hanging out together and allegedly trying to maintain the group, they get arrested, prosecuted for membership of a proscribed group. And, you know, with particular reference to Usman Khan, you know, we're letting somebody out halfway through their sentence who has been a member of a proscribed organisation.
Yeah, and who has also been arrested, convicted and imprisoned for attempting to plot various murders, various murderous schemes, and a whole host of ghastly attacks that were being planned by him and his cohorts. And suddenly the belief is that, oh, well, he's probably going to be fine now because we've had him in prison and he says that he wants to change. I mean, it beggars belief that people are so naive as to take this guy at his word. And I mean, for heaven's sake, the last thing we want to do is be harsh on what the organisation was that hosted him into London. But to give him a free pass to ride on a train on his own, unaccompanied, albeit wearing some kind of monitoring bracelet, is hard to believe in itself. I mean, what if he decided to attack the people on the train?
Well, there's a whole series of possibilities in terms of when he started to plan the attack and what was particularly on his mind. As you say, on this occasion, it seems he was allowed to travel on his own. He'd apparently attended a similar event in the past when he'd been escorted into London. But, you know, the fact you're having to escort somebody, you know, to attend an event surely indicates a degree of danger and a degree of problem potentially about that individual.
Right.
It seems easier not to bother, doesn't it? As you know, as any degree of common sense would would dictate.
But this is my point about the system and the sort of the liberal forgiveness that goes on, which is that basically, oh, well, we can turn him into a nice man. We can turn him away from these hateful thoughts because he's told us that he wants to change. In fact, they were so convinced of his de-radicalisation that they were proposing that he become a student at Cambridge University.
Well, yes. I mean, I'm sure lots of other people would have liked the opportunity to go to Cambridge and didn't get it. I think I made it as far as Wolverhampton Polytechnic.
Yeah.
But the reality as well is, if you look at these things internationally, as our analysts do, we've actually seen similar cases where the authorities appear to have been hoodwinked by somebody, you know, within their bosom, if you like.
Yeah.
So back in 2009, there was a deadly attack, a suicide bombing on the CIA in Afghanistan at Camp Chapman. Somebody they recruited as an informer, somebody who, you know, they believed wanted to work with them to defeat the Taliban. And, you know, he killed those who he'd been working with. And just back in October, the police appear to have missed in France the, remember the guy who murdered four police officers?
Yes.
You know, was somebody working within the intelligence division of the French police. It had been noted, apparently, that he'd made extreme comments around the time of the Charlie Hebdo attacks, but he'd remained in post.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this guy was part of the government's prevent and desistance and disengagement program. He'd joined up, he'd signed up, he'd become one of the subjects of that program. And clearly the people running that program, I'm afraid to say, don't know their elbow from another part of their anatomy.
No, there was a very good piece in the Sunday Times yesterday by Ian Aitchison, who's one of our leading experts on this. And he'd done a big report for the prison service back in... for the Justice Secretary back in 2016, that was opposed by the prison service. And that was very much his finding, that the police and the intelligence services didn't really rate the prison service, didn't think they were on the ball, didn't think they took the challenges seriously enough. And I know that's also been a department that's been greatly underfunded in recent years. But he put forward all these recommendations, and the majority weren't enacted. And that looks now like an enormous blunder.
Yes, it does. And surely now we also have to be looking at a separation of prisoners from regular sort of crime, if you like, and terrorism. You have to treat them differently. I don't think we can be looking at sending terrorists and people who wish to do us harm because of their terrorist ideology into normal prisons with normal people who they might affect even worse.
Well, a lot of these guys are in Category A prison, certainly in the early parts of their sentence. I mean, there's two arguments here, Mike, really, that the danger of just separating people off is that they then, if they're still allowed to associate with each other, is they provide a sort of mutual support network for one another, and, you know, they enforce the rules and regulations, if you like, of the terrorist group, which is what we saw in Northern Ireland, if you remember the different wings in the Maine.
Yes.
You know, the loyalist wing, the IRA wing, and they would be under the control of the officer commanding of the different paramilitary groups.
Yeah.
There's some evidence, there was a guy, O'Doherty, I think he was called, former IRA guy, who insisted in coming out of that system, going into the normal prison population. This was in the late 1980s. And over time, others like him, who didn't agree with the IRA or UDA anymore, were able to go in amongst the sort of ordinary decent criminals and, if you like, became de-radicalized by leaving those structures.
Yes.
So there's a debate here to be had. I think we probably need to move much more towards a system where these guys are separated away, but their association with one another is virtually zero.
Okay.
You know,
I've got a plan for that, Paul. Why don't you just build separate prisons, separate institutions, and just keep them in solitary confinement? You know, I don't really see why anyone who wishes to destroy Western civilization, wishes to destroy Western culture, hates the West because of some ridiculous faith-based ideology. Why in the hell should we treat them the same as we treat everybody else? You know, why can we not treat them as they would treat us, i.e. lock them up and don't let them out?
I think that needs to be part of the review that's going to have to take place, and the sooner it takes place, the better.
You know, and the trouble is, I know very well from just saying what I've said, I'll be labelled as some right-wing fanatic who doesn't believe that people have got any right to liberalism or any right to freedom of speech or any right to freedom of association. Well, I'm sorry. If you're willing to stab innocent people, even those people who are better and even more improved than innocent, they're actually people trying to help you to rehabilitate your life, and you treat them with absolute disdain and you murder them in cold blood. I don't believe anybody like him deserves anything better than to be shot dead like a dog on the bridge.
Well, we've now seen, Mike, I think it's 91 Britons killed in terrorist attacks this century by jihadists. And I think the message does need to get across to people. There's nothing progressive about allowing your fellow citizens to be murdered in the streets.
Exactly right. Dr. Paul Stott, thank you very much indeed. Research fellow at the Henry Jackson Society. I'm sorry, the more I think about what happened on Friday, the more angry I get, because not only is London my city, London Bridge is my bridge. I work here, I live about a mile away. I do not expect to walk to work or any of my colleagues to walk to work and risk being stabbed to death by some lunatic who thinks that he's got it right and we've all got it wrong. I don't see any reason why we should let any of these people out once they've been found guilty and convicted of a terrorism offence. Why should we give them a second chance? What is the point?